the speaker for tonight. I want to say on behalf of Tilda his apologies for not being able to be here for to some unforeseen circumstances. He will join us a little bit later. It's a great pleasure to have today with us a good friend and colleague, Dr. Andreas Karydas. Andreas is Research Director at the Institute of Nuclear and Particle Physics of the National Center for Scientific Research Demokritos in Athens and head of the XRF laboratory. He studied physics at the University of Athens and received his PhD in the field of analytical applications of nuclear techniques from the National Technical University of Athens. Andreas has research experience of more than 25 years, and he has worked in various high-profile laboratories, such as the Nuclear Science and Instrumentation Laboratory at the International Atomic Energy Agency, where he acted as technical officer in more than 20 national and regional technical cooperation projects. In 2015, he received a merit award in recognition of his contribution to the coordination, implementation and commissioning of a new beam line and station at Elettra Synchrotronia in Trieste. His research interests focus towards, firstly, the study of fundamental X-ray interactions with matter, secondly, on the application and the development of analytical methodologies and instrumentation of X-ray fluorescence and ion beam analysis techniques, with emphasis on the areas of cultural heritage, material science, environmental monitoring, and biomedicine. He has coordinated many national, bilateral, and European competitive projects, while he has extensively published more than 116 articles in international peer-reviewed journals and more than 40 in peer-reviewed proceedings of international conferences that have received over 1,300 citations, excluding sub-citations. Last but not least, he has been president of the European X-ray Spectrometry Association for a few years, and also he's a member of the advisory board of the X-ray Spectrometry Board and Microchemical Journal. Today he will present us a part of his latest research on the application of macro XRF on cultural heritage. Andreas, the floor is yours.
Andreas, thank you very much for this very flattering introduction. Good afternoon to all. It's a pleasure to be here after almost 15 years, when it was the last time I visited Nicosia. So I would like to thank Artemios and Tilo for this kind invitation. So as Artemios has mentioned, I will present you some recent results and new interpretations regarding macroscopic X-ray fluorescence imaging of Greek historical and prehistoric antiquities. So here is an outline of my presentation. I will start with some very basics about X-ray fluorescence analysis, just for those who are not very familiar, to introduce you smoothly into this technique. And then I will promptly come into results regarding the high pizza wooden panels, the Greek and Warrior Bronze Age gold rings, some very few results, latest results regarding Cycladic figurines, the polychromy on them, and about Bronze Age wall paintings. So let's start with the working principle of X-ray fluorescence analysis, which can be described as a two-step process. So you have the atom of an element, and then you have some incoming radiation that bombards the atom under investigation, which is including that is included in the material that you would like to analyze. The first step is to expel, to ionize an inner cell electron from its orbit, and then, and this process, it's called photoelectric absorption. At the second step, since the atom becomes in an excited state, we have an electronic transition from an outer cell to the cell that the hole has been created, and we have the emission of a characteristic photon, X-ray photon, which carries a particular energy, which is the fingerprint of the element that has been previously ionized. So by recording this energy here, we will be able to do to perform qualitative analysis. And if we record the number of X-rays over a particular time period, we could perform also quantitative analysis to see how many atoms have been initially ionized by our radiation. So, in principle, coming to the basic, to summarize the basic features of X-ray fluorescence analysis, in principle, in a very abstract way, description, we have an X-ray source, the material that it's composed from different elements that we would like to analyze, and we have an energy dispersive X-ray detector. So I have here summarized, let's say, the most important, according to my opinion, features of X-ray fluorescence analysis, that it is that we can perform simultaneous multi-elemental analysis of almost all elements of the periodic table. Actually, with portable instrumentation, we can analyze elements with atomic number more than 13, that means from silicon upward. But in specialized laboratories under special, let's say, experimental conditions, vacuum, and so on, we can even analyze elements with atomic number from boron upward. I mean, we can, for example, in this case, this spectrum has been obtained at synchrotron in Trieste, and you can see it's a very thin material, a silicon nitride 200 nanometers, and we are able also to measure nitrogen that is coming from the substrate of the silicon nitride film. So there are great potentialities in terms of elemental analysis. The sensitivity, the elemental sensitivity is from a little bit below parts per million. It depends if you analyze a material under specific, let's say, well reproduced and well controlled conditions in the laboratory, as it may happen at synchrotron facilities, or you can go from generally with portable instrumentation from few tens of ppm up to major elements, which are contained in percentage concentration. Of course, the most important is that it is very applicable in the field of cultural heritage is the fact that we can perform non-invasive analysis without any sample, without requiring any to take any sample from the material that we would like to analyze. So portability is another basic aspect of X-ray fluorescence analysis, versatility, the speedness. We can perform analysis in just 1 minute. We can screen many samples or many materials or many positions in one artifact in an hour. So it's very convenient and versatile. In particular cases under control conditions regarding not only our setup but also the preservation state of the surface that we analyze, we can perform also quantitative analysis. And something very, very important to my opinion is that we can model the spectra, what we are actually recording in our detector, by first physical principles. So we can tailor exactly, we can predict what material, what kind of spectrum we are going to receive. Let's come a little bit about micro-X-ray fluorescence analysis. This is a very general diagram of a setup with the source, the sample, and the detector. And actually, the experimental configurations are widespread. This is the basic mode, but for example, between the source and the sample, we can have the so-called primary beam modifier. This is a technical aspect, but this can be simply just a collimator. It could be a filter, or it could be some more complex stage, like a monochromator. It could be a multilayer, a crystal. It could be some optics device. And in that case, when we use a particular optics device between X-ray cube and the sample, then which is called polycapillary X-ray lens, then we can have we can direct the beam in a very small dimension below 0.1 millimeter, below 1/10 of millimeter. So this is really something that became feasible the last 15 years and boosted very much the development of micro X-ray fluorescence non-invasive analysis, even in the field. Let's see, concerning the measurement methodologies that we may have with micro-X-ray fluorescence, for example, there are different strategies. In this case here, we have the beam, the source irradiating the whole surface of our sample, but then we have different options in order to take spatially resolved information. What I mean spatially resolved, it means that we are getting in our detection system, particularly for, we know from which position of the sample with micrometric precision from where we are getting the signal. So there are different optics arrangement, I'm not going into detail. The most common that we are going to elaborate today in this presentation is that we have the option of two-dimensional scanning. This means that we can move our sample in front of the beam in two vertical perpendicular directions, or opposite, or equivalent, we can move our spectrometer head in front of the sample with micrometric resolution. In that way, we take many spectra at different positions, and then we will be able to produce the so-called elemental maps. Okay, so all the measurements that I'm going to present you today, they have been carried out through a collaboration with a group from Sicily, from Catania, the group of Paolo Romano from the Labs Laboratory. You see here this their configuration, experimental configuration. This is the X-ray source with a polycapillary lens, the two X-ray detectors, and here is the sample. So the benefit of having the polycapillary lens is the following, is that if you put your sample, this system can be moved in a motorized XYZ state. So the whole system is moving, not the object, so it's quite safe. The other aspect and feature of this spectrometer is the following. If we put the sample at the focal spot size, then we have an ultimate spatial resolution of 0.05 millimeters, 50 micrometers. But if we can go away, and this is what we do when we have to map large surfaces, we do not need really 50 micrometers. We can go a little bit out of the focus here, and then we can have 200 or 500 micrometers, half a millimeter, and then with this spatial resolution, we can map very large surfaces, which are the order of square meters. So I can give you one example here. This is resonance painting from 1640, 2 by 1.5 meters. And this was scanned with a resolution of 1 millimeter, spatial resolution of 1 millimeter, in almost 10 hours. And then here you see how the painting looks like. And then by doing this measurement, the macroscopic XRF imaging, we can obtain different images of the painting at different, at specific wavelengths that correspond to the distribution of different elements. For example, here we see where the lead is distributed with more open, with a more white color means higher intensity. With more, where it's black, the intensity is very low. So we see the distribution of lead. We see the distribution of mercury. You see the red cinnabar. You see the distribution of iron, which is more probably some ochre materials. You see the distribution of antimony, probably is coming from lead antimonate or calcium antimonate. This is the distribution of manganese. And this we can combine also to see different aspects. So it's a different, a new world where you have the visual image, but then by doing this mapping, you have a distribution, different maps, which correspond to the distribution of different chemical elements. So I will complete, just to give you some aspects of how the analysis is done, but I have already explained to you, so I will go a little bit fast. This is the XRF spectrum by recording millions of, I mean, you can see here, for example, that the number of spectra are huge, 3.2 mega, millions of spectra that have been acquired. And here you see, for example, in a typical spectrum, by the analysis of characteristic X-ray peaks, here is the calcium, we have here the titanium and zinc, we can create these elemental maps. Now, just to complete this introduction, there are more elaborated ways of doing the mapping. And what it happens when you don't have a flat surface, because we are going to talk about it, but when you have a cylindrical surface, as it is in the case of a ceramic vase. Here, how you could perform the elemental mapping. So in that case, you could combine translational and rotational scanning. And this is what was done here. Of course, for example, this is the results which have been projected, of course, in a plane. You see here the calcium, as you can see here, these figures have been painted with calcium carbonate. You have the black cloth, which is rich in iron. It's the so-called iron reduction technique that has been used, elaborated during classical period. And you see here iron, the distribution, the calcium in the figures and the horses, and potassium, which is very much well associated, because for producing this black cloth, you have to use fine lithic clay, which is rich in potassium. Now, it's interesting that, as I show you here, that if you combine the elemental mapping with the laser scanning, then you may plot these images on the surface of the ceramic. And this small video illustrates to you. This is the distribution of calcium. Instead of having the elemental maps projected in two-dimensional, now they have been placed on the surface of the object and reproduces, of course, much better the real situation. And here is the iron map, which is the black gloss layer, which is the base of the surface of the ceramic where the figures and the horses have been painted. Okay, so this was related with my introduction about macroscopic XRF, and then the first topic of my presentation will be about the analysis macro XRF imaging of the high pizza panels. In this project, it is just published by Journal TechNet. We are just now correcting the proofs. This project was led by my colleague Harikle Brekulaki from Institute of Historical Research, the National Research Foundation in Athens, and a multidisciplinary team has collaborated, Giovanni Veri from the Art Institute of Chicago, who performed infrared reflected imaging, ultraviolet and visible induced luminescence, Brigitte Bourgeois from Museum de France, Paolo Romano, Claudia Calieri, and myself, and George Cavadillas from the National Archaeological Museum. Here you see part of the team, and during the analysis of one of the panels. So you see here the four panels that we are going to discuss today. The first one on the left is the procession in honors of the nymphs. First of all, to say that all panels have been discovered in 1934 in Ano Pizza in Corinthia, which is a village west of Sikion. And all these panels have been found within a cave. It is supposed that they were deposited there as votive offerings to a local cult of nymphs or to other Chthonian divinities. So the microclimate conditions of the cave have to greatly extent preserved the all these panels because of the lack of oxygen, of the lack or also the absence of sunlight. And all these panels, the other fortunate thing is that they were all was on the top of the other. So the only one that has been less preserved, that its external surface was exposed to environmental condition, is this panel here that represents a ritual dance. But this is the last
preserved panel, but of course we have the other two. This is the most well preserved. And here we have the panel that shows draft figures holding necklaces. We're going to discuss a little bit about this. And here the other panel presents three overlapping female figures. So we will start with the first one, that it is less preserved, but that also the results were quite interesting. So you can see here the scene that depicts a ritual dance, perhaps a dance of deities. We have five women, one, two, three, four, five, elegantly dressed in a peplos and a himation, pulled up to cover their hands. And we have faint patches of color here and traces of preliminary drawing of four additional female figures, which are hardly visible by naked eye here. And also, maybe you can see here, you can recognize a flute player, which is also hardly discernible. Okay, so what we see here, we see how we see the infrared reflected image, where we can observe, you see, the flute player. It's much more better visualized in the IR image. We see here the veil. The veil, as you probably know, visualizes the distribution of Egyptian blue. And here, whenever you see this white, means there is a presence of Egyptian blue pigment. So it's sensitive to the particular synthetic pigment. And here you see the results of the macro X-ray fluorescence imaging in RGB correlation. This means that we have used red color. This, I'm going to use this representation quite often during my presentation. We see mercury as red, arsenic as blue, and iron as green. And then, of course, when you have intermixture of these colors, you have these hues which are presented here in between. So, first of all, I will come into more details to each one of these images. First of all, the IR image provided some really spectacular results because it was possible to recognize some names about the nymphs. You see that from the right to the left, you see the names of Telesoi and Lefkipa, which is the early attestation of these names. Also, then you see Calypso, Telesoi and Lefkipa, and then you see Calypsoi, which is hitherto attested as a personal name in non-literary sources. It's the first time that it is found in any inscription, whereas the other names were not very clear. So the question, are these nine figures are the nymphs? Concerning the two names, are indeed the names of oceanic nymphs, but of course we cannot generalize because the other names might be belong to a local tradition of nymphs, or they just represent the women participating in the ceremony. Now, let's come to the macro XRF imaging in the RGB correlation. First of all, you see that cinnabar, which is this, which is represented by the presence and distribution of mercury in this map, it has been used to promote the vividness of the garments. But also, as you can see here, to outline the figures of the Gesso background. I forgot to say that the background, and for the first time so early, has been identified to be calcium sulfate. Cinnabars has been used for the garments, but also to outline the facial features, as you can see in some other female figures here. Then we have also a cinnabar that has been used, perhaps in mixture, but we don't know this, maybe has been gone away, the other pigment, but it seems that clearly here that has been used also to fill the nude parts of the flute player, which is also something a little bit unusual because for the Greek practice, because usually for the skin of the naked skin, they use ochres,
ochre materials. Now, concerning iron. Iron is visualized here with a green color. And iron, you see that has been used, dark red, has been used to serve the frame of the composition. The green is myrtle wreaths over here, and which were around the heads of the dancers, and also for the light brown orange hair. What has been revealed by macro X-ray fluorescence imaging that was not visible to the naked eye, it is an enthralled female deity here, below the flute player, with a long hair which has been depicted by iron ochre, as you can see in green, and the footstool, which is painted also with an iron-based ochre. The female figure also wears a cinnabar red hematium and holds, maybe you don't see it very well, but holds, you see here, a circular object, which is also painted with cinnabar. And all these aspects and features were not really visible by naked eye. Let's go to some details in order to conclude about this panel. If you see in the microphotograph of this area here, you see the sequence and superimposition of different paint layers. You see in position one, we have the gypsum preparation. Then we have the first layer of a yellow pigment. I have not talked about this yet. And then on the position three, we have a superimposition of the yellow with a brown layer, which presumably is an iron ochre. So we have a sequence here and particular practice in applying in order to produce this visual effect of the hair of the female deities. And you can see even better here that arsenic distribution is illustrated here with these black lines together with iron, which also, of course, has been used also for the reds and the hair. In addition, this arsenic-based pigment most likely should be attributed to the use of orpiment, which is arsenical sulfide pigment. Okay, now let's go to the second panel, which is the best preserved panel. And here I have summarized the results, but I will come into more details. Here is this panel, which is called is a family procession. To a sacrifice in the honor of the nymphs. It's a very obvious theme and a very vastly reproduced by scholars. Here you see again the infrared reflected image where we can observe that the black hair and the outlines have been executed using carbon black. And again, here we have the visible induced luminescence it visualizes distribution of Egyptian blue. Okay, it's clear that the blue here we see on the dresses, it is based on Egyptian blue. And here is the results of the macro X-ray fluorescence imaging. What you observe, again, we are using RGB correlation, iron, arsenic, and copper. And I will come into more detail to explain to you the different features. Of course, as I mentioned before, all these panels have been executed in calcium, in gypsum substrate. And here is very clear the elemental map of calcium. With open color, we see higher calcium presence together in a close association, spatial association with sulfur. So let's come into more detail because it's quite interesting to see some interesting aspects of this panel. Here you see the distribution of iron, which has been used, a dark red ochre has been used for the chiton and mattia, but also has been used for the skin through a mixture of hematite and gypsum to open the color. Whereas also here a mixture of yellow ochre and carbon black has been used for the pale olive green of the myrtle wreaths on the heads of the figures and the branches, as you can see here. Now, concerning the Doric petals of the female figures have been executed using Egyptian blue that was also not too very nice clarity, but certainly was really reconfirmed by Veal, which is actually the technique sensitive to Egyptian blue, but also we were able, of course, to detect and associate with the presence of copper silicone, but actually the same graph, the same map. Now, what was interesting here is that we have seen that in the positions where there was the Egyptian blue, there was also high density of iron, and we are wondering why iron is located together with Egyptian blue. Has anything to do with a particular mixture, or it was a different sequence of different layers. That means that the Egyptian blue has been executed on the top of a brown ochre layer. And in order to clarify this using our data, we have performed here from this imaging, because all this panel, for practical reasons, was not executed in once, but in two consequent scans. And you see the map, it's a little bit reversed, because you see here the altar, you see it opposite. And from this aerial scanning, you see the correlation, the uncorrelation, actually, of copper versus iron. They are completely uncorrelated. If there was a mixture, then you would expect that this data should form more or less a good line. So these two data are completely uncorrelated, and moreover, you can see that the outline of an iron map are much better preserved than the copper one. So it's clearly, that also was confirmed from microphotographs, that there is Egyptian blue in this particular case was executed on the brown ochre layer. So there is a sequence of different paint layers. And now I'm coming to describe a little bit the presence, to explain to you the presence of arsenic, which is also attributed here to the use of arsenic sulfide, the orpiment, which has been used for the decorative belts of the peploi and of the bands here, and for the sound chest of the lyre, for the small round cushion, for the tray and wooden box and jacks, and finally, that was not initially visible, for the flames of the altar fire. And you should take into account orpiment is a very bright and precious pigment, and most likely has been used here to imitate for these decorative bands and belts, has been used to imitate the shiny surface of a metallic element, and of course for the glow of the fire. Why we don't see today the orpiment? Because it has been faded out and is white, and it is mixed with a white substrate, so that's why we can't see it. Now we come to the third panel, where we have three overlapping female figures, 1, 2, 3. They are not very well recognized, but indeed they are there. And this is a fragment of the original composition, and we see only the lower of two-thirds of the female triad with overlapping bodies, standing on a ground line facing right. Also this panel is inscribed to the nymphs. And we see that the dresses are decorated with different geometrical motifs, mostly meanders, as we can see here, different variant complexity, dots, and small squares, as you can see here. Now, some details. If you see the detail of this part here, you see a thick white line, which resembles the impasto effect and produces this ornamented meander. But also, it's quite interesting, between the two meanders, you see this yellow part, which is under the microphotograph, preserves grains of a yellow pigment, which is again the same pigment that we have found in the other two panels, which is again the orpiment. And you can see here this faded meander is represented, it has been identified by macro XRF imaging regarding the arsenic presence. Now, it's quite interesting also to see, we see here the RGB correlation of iron, copper, and mercury. And what is quite interesting to discuss a little bit the application of Egyptian blue. We have seen in the previous panel, the Egyptian blue has been applied on a brown ochre layer. But in this case, we see two different techniques. Concerning these dots here, there is a coarse grain Egyptian blue that has been used immediately on the red background. But in order to produce the dark blue hue of these bands here, we have a superimposition of two layers of Egyptian blue, one coarse grain, as you can see, one fine grain on the above the substrate, and then another one which is, has a darker hue, which is also coarse grain, as you can see here in the microphotograph. So we have two different ways in order to produce different visual effects. And now we are going to the last panel to give you some results. As you can see here, this panel visualizes draft figures holding necklaces. You see here one necklace, and some other, it's supposed to be here. It's again a triad of overlapping figures facing to the right, and probably with a woman which holds a necklace that you can see here with, that has blue and yellow spherical beads. Most probably, the colors have been chosen in order to evoke the color of blue faience or precious lapis lazuli. Here at the right end, we can see braille snakes in blue and brown, perhaps representing another pendant. And we can see also there is some inscription here that you can see in the iron map here, much better. You see here the distribution of mercury for the red, which has been used here, and also for the braille snakes over here. And concerning now, again, we see also the presence of arsenic for the yellow beads and for the copper, for the yellow as they look right now, today, and copper also for the blue. Let's see if we see the palette of colors that have been used in this particular panel. We see four different pigments, cinnabar, ochres, again an arsenic-based pigment, and Egyptian blue. Now, what is interesting here is that this is the panel as dated back, as it has been photographed that, back in 1986. And you see that the yellow, the today yellow beads here, they look red. And actually, the copy that was done quite early in the 60s, by an artist who was quite famous, I don't remember his name, but again, he has depicted the beads between the blue ones as red ones. So today, it's clearly that, as you see with the naked eye, they look as yellow ones. So this is the fact because the most likely, not most likely, the results also of micro-Raman spectroscopy have confirmed that the algar has been used, and this is photosensitive pigment that has been turned into the light-induced polymorph, which is yellow. And previous measurements that have been done with the micro-Raman have confirmed the presence of para-realga. So actually, indeed, the arsenic-based pigment that was used at the beginning was not orpiment in this particular case, but realga. So both these arsenic-based pigments, orpiment and realga, it is attested that they are, have been discovered for it's the earliest occurrence of these pigments in ancient painting. Concerning, of course, not in Egypt, of course, we have very many polychromy that it is based on arsenic-based pigments, but nothing from Greece and from our area in general. And in fact, the microphotograph still, as you can see here, it can really has identified the presence of some small red grains still preserved, but very few of them. Okay, just to conclude this presentation regarding the pizza panels and to move on, we are in the progress of producing new results. We have a lot of interesting information, and this is just to show you attempts we are performing right now in order to reproduce the stratigraphy of the different paint layers in a quantitative way. And this is our Monte Carlo simulations of the gypsum layer, of the rod ochre layer, where, of course, we have selected areas where the paint layers have been well preserved. So as a result, just to what macroscopic X-ray fluorescence has offered to us, a better understanding of the paint iconography and interpretation of the meaning of the different scenes, but also the recovery of multiple figurative elements that have remained previously unseen. Also, we have revealed similarities and differences in terms of technique and style. It has been considered that the panels have been produced from different workshops, but we have suggested that most likely have been produced in the same workshop, perhaps by different hands. We have certain similarities. The palette of pigments is the same, and other stylistic aspects of the application of the pigments are similar. Of course, there are exceptions. But of course, there are some differences, such as the density of the figures and the folding and the elaboration of the garments that have to do with the particular taste of the artisan. But as I have mentioned, that perhaps different hands have been worked in the same workshop, because really the use of the same and let's say rare pigments in the different panels is a very connecting point between them. And also we would be able, but I didn't have the time to show you that through trace element analysis, we would be able to connect the use of ochre in different, to conclude that the same ochre material has been used in different panels based on the trace element that appear in the associated with the ochre. Okay, let's move on to another project which is quite recent, but we are in the process to publicize the results. Again, I have to say that with the contribution of Sanos Tokyo, the excavators of the Gold Rings, and Jack Davis from the University of Cincinnati. Here you see the four gold rings that have been found in the Griffin Warrior Tomb in Pylos. Here we see the bull and bull leaper, female figures flanking a shrine, five female figures. Here we have a female figure with a staff flanked by two birds. And here we have a seated female figure approached by a smaller woman. This was discovered and excavated at the Palace of Nestor between May and October 2015 by Sanos Tokyo and Jack Davis. If you want more information about the gold rings, this is the publication. And here you see the tomb, which is covered here. So, the chemical composition of the gold rings, you see here in the ternary diagram, gold, silver, and copper, and we have different data for bezel and hoop. Generally, bezel and hoop are different, have a little bit different composition, not exactly the same, so different materials have been used. You see that three of the four rings have more or less similar composition, but one of them has more than 90% of gold. This is the with the five female figures with the shrine. What we can see here in comparison of silver versus copper content, these are our data from the four rings, together with other data that have been published before, mostly by Hartmann, but also by others. We see that actually they form a different group, but on the other hand, this high silver concentration has been criticized in a recent publication by Warner, not so recent, but many artifacts that have been analyzed by Hartmann have been reanalyzed by
a group by Warner et al. And they have found that it seems that the silver content has been overestimated in Hartmann's data, whereas copper has been found to not have been changed really. Anyway, this is not the main aspect of my presentation, just to give you an idea. So we have 80% of gold and more than 92 to 94% for one of the rings, and very low copper content. So it seems that most of the rings have been produced by unalloyed gold. And here you see the elemental map of that we have taken of gold, silver, and copper by analyzing the whole surface of the rings with 50 micron spatial resolution. You see also some salt deposition in the engraved area, indicated by the presence of silicon and calcium. But also it's rather characteristic, the presence of the elevated presence of copper. So you can see here that elevated presence of copper systematically has been observed in all graved areas of the four copper rings. You can see here that in all cases you have more copper content. There are two possible scenarios that this is, might be because of the tool that has been used in order to make these engravations, or to less extent might be due to the contamination from the other copper artifacts that have been, that there were a lot of them that they were found in the Griffin Warrior tomb. The rings have been analyzed in the combined rotational and translational mode. As you can see here, we have put them in the rotational axis and they have been rotated and translated up and down. In this way, it was possible to have in the same way the elemental distribution, not only in the bezel, but also in the hoop, as you can see here, and to create projections of the elemental composition in 2D. And this was very useful because we were able to identify particular areas, for example, the soldering areas, and to see if something changes regarding the composition, the chemical composition of those areas. But also, we were able to identify a small mineral inclusions on the surface of the ring, as we are going to show you just now. First of all, as you can see here, by mapping in this way the surface of the ring, we're able to see here where there is obvious a soldering area, more increase of copper content. But by doing this more carefully and by doing some changing, let's say, the pixel size, we see that we have enhanced presence of silver and copper content that indicates the use of a hard solder to join the two parts of the gold metal. In some other cases, here you see two areas, the comparison of two spectra from the soldering and the pure metal, you see elevated silver and elevated copper content, where gold is the same. In other cases, we have seen only elevated copper content that indicates the use of solid-state diffusion technique. So two different techniques have been elaborated even in the same ring. Now, the most spectacular, let's say, result is that that doing this with a high lateral resolution, the scanning with high lateral resolution and chemical sensitivity, we're able to isolate small inclusions, mineral inclusions, which were rich in platinum group elements like iridium, osmium, and ruthenium, which were not possible. Usually, you have to move the object to the laboratory and to perform detailed examination of the surface by scanning electron microscope and to identify with the backscattering mode where are the inclusions and then to perform EDS analysis. But in this way, just in 2 hours, we're able to scan the whole surface to identify if there were any inclusion present on the surface or either on the bezel or on the hoop, and then to perform a more detailed scanning with a higher, in order to be able to perform a more precise quantitative analysis. Here you see a typical example from an inclusion. You see the elevated presence of osmium, iridium, and ruthenium versus
the pure metal. It's a very clear and a very strong signal. And what this indicates, it is very important because we can suggest that the origin of the gold metal is coming from secondary alluvial deposits. When you observe and when you, it's possible to identify platinum group mineral inclusions in the gold metal, then for sure, then the origin of the metal is coming from secondary placer deposits. So now, of course, another interesting aspect is the alignment feature of PGM inclusions in the hoop of one ring. You see that have been aligned across a line, in many inclusions across the line, and this is, has been already observed and documented by other people also where they have found PGM inclusions. Now, okay, and what is the result? I mean, what does it mean? Of course, the first thing we have done, because this is a work in progress, is that we have plotted our data together with many other data that are have been produced by scholars, by NICSA. This is the only early publication from 1980, from the British Museum. From gold objects from Mesopotamia, Minor Asia, and Egypt. And the most recent publication from Lemasson, Janssen, Troalen, and Minyaki are coming mostly from Egyptian jewelry. So we see a lot of similarities. Of course, there are differences. It doesn't mean that we can have, we could conclude the provenance of the gold metal, because this is really, it has been, there is a long, big debate about the possibility of using the PGEs for provenance, but at least we try to see similarities with other published data and then to proceed step by step. So this is something that also is somehow compatible with the with what the archaeologists think, that these objects might have an origin from Egypt. But this is only a speculation. So, just to conclude about this project that have shown that the XRF results have shown that the rings were produced by unalloyed gold metal. Solid areas have been better documented by macroscopic XRF imaging, revealing the use of different techniques. And the discovery of platinum group mineral inclusion is reported for the first time in Kina gold by means of a portable, non-invasive technique, and further suggesting an origin for the three of the four rings from a secondary alluvial deposit. I will have a few slides, maybe 5 minutes more, if it's possible. Just this is also a work in progress. We have tried to see the feasibility of the technique to analyze the remaining polychromy on Cycladic figurines. And through the leadership of Nikos Papadimitriou and Sofia Sotiropoulou, we have been invited to analyze some particular in the Cycladic Museum and the National Archaeological Museum, some Cycladic edolia. Here you see the instrument when we perform the analysis. And here you see some results, for example, from this head. You see clear evidence of the presence of mercury, which is seen here with some black spots. But here you see also the frame and the location where the pigment has been used. Mercury is here, but also you see some other elements that in some cases might be relevant with the chemical composition of the marble or because of the salt deposition, of course. And just to give you another example, which is more characteristic, this is the investigated area of the arms of another figurine from the Cycladic Museum. You see the elemental maps that we have deduced from different for different elements. Again, we see a geometrical pattern of mercury, as you can see here, but it's very characteristic that from the RGB correlation of mercury, iron, and calcium maps, we can observe, first of all, that iron is a superficial contamination from the soil environment, which is
on the top of this area. Then we have the geometrical pattern of mercury stripes, of cinnabar stripes. And then you see that calcium looks a little bit, this is of course a speculation, that it looks that it has been prepared to have a smooth surface in order to apply this decorative motif. Okay, and then just a very characteristic example to conclude my presentation. This has been also just published in Journal of Archaeological Science and Report, so you may find more information if you are interested about this work. We have also exploited the application of the technique for analyzing very degraded wall paintings from the Palace of Nestor. But I will show you, just to give you an archaeological context, the Palace of Nestor was discovered by Carl Bliegen, an archaeologist, an American archaeologist from the University of Cincinnati. The wall paintings have been characterized by their high artistic quality, iconographic variety, and also it has been confirmed that Seco techniques have been used. So I will give you only the results of this fragment. As you can see here, this is the battle scene of Hall 64. This fragment has been visualized by Pete de Jong here. So we have analyzed, this is a warrior holding here a knife. This was the part that we have analyzed. So which are the results? You can see here that we have iron distribution, the copper distribution, and manganese. So iron, most likely an iron ochre has been used. Copper. We have confirmed the presence of silicon, so for sure Egyptian blue has been used. And we have also manganese compound, most likely might be pyrolusite, which is abutan in South Peloponnese, or it might be also torodokite, but we cannot really confirm the mineralogical form of manganese compound. So let's see what further on, what kind of information about the application technique these data show. The images tell us is that the main figure has been executed directly on the plaster, as you can see here. The background coloration surrounds the main pre-drawn figure. The background coloration has been a mix of Murex purple that has been confirmed by high-performance liquid chromatography, but also with the presence of bromine that I don't have the time to show you, with mixed Murex purple with Egyptian blue. So that's why the background is characterized by the presence of copper, which surrounds the main figure. And then secondary details like, for example, the black decorative of the dress of the warrior has been put on the top. So this sequence is the sequence of the application of the different pigments is really very nicely visualized by putting in context the information that you are gathering from elemental maps. So just I have in this very short presentation about the iconography of Pylos wall painting, just to summarize some results that. For sure, because I was analyzing for a long time with single spot XRF analysis, and it was really the results by macroscopic XRF have no any comparison in terms not only on the richness of the analytical data, but in the way that you are able to make solid and robust interpretations. So we are able to make a reassessment of previous reconstructions to understand better the nature of pigments used and painting techniques, and also to identify different application techniques. For example, in the scene that I have not shown you, Murex purple was mixed with Egyptian blue. And here in the battle scene, we had also Egyptian blue on the top of Murex purple that has been also mixed with Egyptian blue. There was a particular stratigraphy.
So thank you very much for your attention, and I'm glad. I have to thank also the archaeologists. Without them, the access to the material would be really impossible. And I have to say my sincere thanks, because they have really believed the potential of the technique to provide some useful results.
Yeah. Thank you very much, Andreas, for this very informative presentation, for the benefits of macro XRF through these three case studies. We have some time for maybe two or three short questions.
I'm wondering if you could take us back to your slide where you had the two elemental concentrations plotted against one another. They were, I think, counts
with copper,
copper and iron, I believe.
Yes.
If I understood your argument correctly, you're saying that because they're not correlated, those two pigments were applied as separate applications, whereas if they had been mixed before applying, you'd expect a linear relationship. And yet those data were collected in two different scan passes.
No, no, the same time.
Same time.
Same time. It's that one here has been collected as the scanner analyzes the surface. So you take the spectrum, you analyze the copper peak, the iron peak, and then you plot the data.
Okay.
When you have if these elements are associated in the main material, they should be in a constant relation or in constant weight ratio. The fact that there are the data look like that, because you cannot control the one influence, the thickness of the top layer influences the signal that is coming from below, and the top layer is not a constant thickness, cannot be, and because also of the lack of good preservation of the surface. So that's why there is also this scatter of data.
Thank you.
Tilo?
Andreas, really many thanks also from me for this talk, and I'm sorry I came late. Maybe you have said it earlier, but how long does it take to run these scans?
The pizza panels that we have analyzed with half a millimeter spatial resolution, but they were 30 centimeter by 15 on average, it took 2 hours.
Okay.
It's very fast. It can go even with 10 milliseconds per pixel. So,
so what dwell time do you have per pixel, milliseconds?
Millisecond, 10, 20, 30, 40.
But then you have background problems, or you have good enough detector?
Good detectors, but you need high throw output exactly in order to be able to have reasonable statistics in a fraction of a second.
Great. Thank you.
Yes?
That's a short question. You can apply these methods also for analyzing the different kinds of ink or written sources.
Yes, absolutely.
Because
yes.
Actually, the cinnabar signatures.
Yes, yes, absolutely. I mean, one of the first demonstrations of the potentialities of this technique was, if I remember well, from the States, from Stanford, when they have used cyclotron radiation before 2010, when they have analyzed the bulb set of Archimedes, bad preserved parchment. When they were able to reveal lettering and so on, I think there was a lot of publicity on that event.
Mm-hmm.
So of course, yes, it is used also, you know, on a regular basis.
But you can use also the PXRF,
yes,
for the black ink for finding the iron,
yes,
component. But this is the PXRF method that can be used.
No, no, for isolated spots to identify the different thickness, of course, you can make spot analysis. You can analyze different spots, and then you can have an idea. I mean, in the case, with the mapping, you have, you produce the iconography, the whole iconography, and you see the whole distribution of one element in the whole surface. So this is very helpful, when, especially when your object is degraded, it has suffered some degradation on the surface, the painting materials. But in the case of inks, I've seen also the application of the technique for recovering the lettering. But if the letters and the ink is well preserved, of course you can do spot analysis, but still it is possible that you, by not analyzing all spots, to not have the complete information about the presence of different pigments. This is the only problem, if it is a problem, of course.
Thank you.
Yeah, one last one.
Your platinum group metals, I was wondering if you could just elaborate on that a little bit more. If I understand correctly, the reason why you're proposing an alluvial source for those metals is because those refractory metals would have been removed during smelting into the slag?
No. Actually, they follow the smelting, and they are quite well attached. I mean, platinum much better, but also inclusions, they are well preserved, and they are not really melt, they're following the whole process. They follow the basic base metal. The fact is that it's just only the process how these grains are accumulated on the gold. It's just by coming from with the river, erosion, and by gravity, they are correlated with the base metal, with the gold.
So it's a physical.
Absolutely, gold. Yes. It's a physical process, but maybe Tilo, he is more expert.
Yeah, sorry for interjecting, but the river will collect the heavy minerals from whatever background rocks, and you can have different rocks which have platinum groups and other rocks which have gold. And they are mixed in the river. If you mine the gold, it's a primary ore, there is no platinum in it. But if you have it in a river which happens to run through different rock formations, it combines the two. If you then pen and wash the gold from that river, you get the inclusions. But you wouldn't get them if, as the Egyptians did in that time, go up to Wadi Hammamat and mine your quartz veins for the pure gold and crush the quartz and wash the gold, no platinum. But if you have it on the river, you get it.
Okay? Thank you once again, Andreas, and please...